Very much. I really appreciate it. And hello, welcome everyone. Welcome. delight to be here today to talk to you about pandemic triage and whether people's decisions to engage in pandemic triage undermine trust in the medical system. So more broadly, what I'm interested in is how lay people and how especially people who are doctors and physicians and other people in the medical system, how do they view COVID-19 sacrificial decisions? So I've got Robert De Niro here, he's watching you as you face these horrible trade-offs and then in the healthcare context, right? So these are studies that I conducted largely at Florida State University, but now I'm at the University of Portsmouth. And so I have Americans as most of my samples. Also a bit personally relevant because I managed to get COVID myself over the weekend. So apologies for that, but I'm gonna try and barrel through here. Thank goodness I am triple vaxxed. Okay, so sacrificial moral dilemmas are an interesting area of study. They come to us originally from philosophy, or you may have heard of this famous, a bit silly case with this runaway trolley that's about to run over five people, but you could make it run over one person instead, right? And so the question is, should you press this button to make this trolley run over one person, killing them, becoming a murderer in the service of the public good, but by doing so, creating the greatest good for the greatest number? Right? And so there's this question in sacrificial dilemmas of how do you choose between different lives, especially when there's fewer lives in one case, but more lives in the other, but your actions could make the difference, right? Okay. So when you face these types of questions, there's a lot of different examples in the philosophy literature. And then starting at around the turn of the millennium, psychologists started getting involved saying, what are the factors that are influencing people's decisions in these types of sacrificial dilemmas? So when people say, no, I wouldn't cause this harm. I would never sacrifice one, even to save five lives. I'm just going to sit back and watch this carnage go down. I'm going to let it happen. You know, God sent the trolley, or, you know, it's not my place to kill people. One of the important factors that research suggests is going on for people is this affective reaction to harm. People are having this emotional reaction. They're thinking, I can't become a murderer. I can't be the one to hurt this person. I can't be the one. This human deserves as much life as anyone. And we know in the psychological literature that zeroing and focusing on a single target as opposed to a group of targets, it allows us to sort of emotionally to empathize with them. It really highlights their emotions and allows for an emotional connection with them. With a whole group of people, you lose the feeling of this personal emotional connection. They become sort of a sea of numbers. So it's more dispassionate to think of a group of people than an individual. So the more people focus on this individual, the more they seem to be having this affective reaction to harm that motivates them to say, no, I won't cause harm even to save five lives. Now, people like to call this the deontological decision because it's consistent with deontological ethics that were made famous by Immanuel Kant, where he argued that, you know, you can't make any sacrifice for any reason because you have to sort of follow these universal moral rules absolutely. So you have to judge actions by their intrinsic nature. So causing harm is never acceptable because the act of causing harm is always wrong and outcomes are irrelevant according to these deontological perspectives. These decisions could be said to be consistent with deontological ethics, but that doesn't mean they're driven by the same things that philosophers think about, right? Okay. In these kinds of cases, when you say, yes, you should cause harm, you should actually kill this person and save these five lives, you absolutely need to do the best thing for the most people, right? This is consistent with utilitarian ethics now, right? So this is now consistent with the ethics of people like Peter Singer, Jeremy Bentham, John Stuart Mill, who argue that actually the way you should judge moral actions is by the outcomes they produce. Any action that produces the best overall consequences for society is a moral action by default. And so that means in a case like this, you have to sacrifice the one to save the five people. It's the only ethical thing to do because five people over here are also human beings who deserve, you know, well-being and support. And when it comes to medical triage, this seems to be the perspective that's focused on by most hospitals and most situation here. Okay, so we've got a problem when it comes to things like medical triage, right? Between this affective reaction to harm and this cognitive evaluation of outcomes that a lot of research suggests is a primary factor driving these kinds of judgments, right? Okay, so there's a lot of research suggesting that people are facing these sort of trade-offs in the non-medical world. And what we're interested in as well is what happens when other people make these kinds of judgments. So research then went on to say, what are people thinking about others' judgments? So when someone else says, no, I won't turn this trolley, I won't kill this person, I won't do it, even though five lives are on the line, people generally interpret that as an emotional reaction that's focused on concern for the individual victims, and they infer that that person is therefore warm, moral, and trustworthy. They say, wow, what a great person. This person has principles, this person has standards, this person cares about individual human beings. They wouldn't kill someone even to save five people. They are a great person. You should make them your business partner. You should make them your romantic partner. One study suggests that this is a good thing to say on a first date, right? On the other hand, when people say, yes, you should kill that person. Kill that person to save these lives. People think, wow, this person's really logical and intelligent and competent. What a great leader. But they're kind of cold and untrustworthy, aren't they? You wouldn't really want them to babysit your children. You wouldn't really want them to date your daughter, would you? Right? They're the kind of person you want to be in charge somewhere else, far away and distant, but you don't want a warm social relationship. So it turns out a lot of research shows there's actually this trade-off. So this is from a paper we did back in 2017, showing that when you measure perceptions of warmth, so how the warm, trustworthy, moral, friendly is a person, when those in the red bar who reject causing this sacrificial harm and say, no way, I would never kill a person even to save five lives, they're rated as warmer, but less competent, right? You actually get a trade-off compared to the blue bars, right? So the blue bars are people who say, yep, I accept causing harm. I will sacrifice one to save five lives. They're rated as less warm, but more competent. So you end up with this crossover interaction, this warmth-competence trade-off. Causing harm in service of the greater good is viewed as good leadership activity and smart and intelligent, but it comes at this cost, this interpersonal cost that can undermine trust and undermine warmth. And as people know in the medical system, things like trust in your doctor are really important if people are going to come see you and follow medical advice, right? So that leads us to this question, okay, how are people thinking about COVID-19? It really matters a lot. So in one more case where it matters, we've done some studies looking at social role selection, right? So imagine two different doctors, and this is a work done before the pandemic. There's one version of the dilemma is a sick Johnny dilemma, where imagine little Johnny is very ill, and you could spend, say, $1 million to save little Johnny's life, but that's going to cost time and resources that are going to prevent the hospital from saving the lives of future children, right? On the other hand, a doctor could say, nope, sorry, we're going to let little Johnny die, but we're going to take that $1 million, we're going to invest it in all this new equipment. And this new equipment is going to equip us with the resources we need to save several children down the line. Imagine two different doctors, they reach a different opinion. We asked people, who do you want to be your child's pediatrician? And they want the doctor who will do anything to save Johnny. They don't want the person who will let Johnny die. But we said then, okay, well, who do you want to run the hospital? And it flips. Right? They want the person who lets Johnny die to run the hospital, but they don't want him to be their own child's doctor. So you end up, it's again, consistent with this warmth competence trade-off. They want the doctor who will invest anything at any cost to save the individual for a personal connection, but they do recognize the value of this sort of leadership thinking overall in broad terms of sacrificing some to save lives, right? So with this background, we thought, okay, what's going on here when people encounter COVID-19 sacrificial dilemmas, which became a real thing, as we all know, in the early stages of the pandemic. So this became a bunch of media stories. One of the very first cases was out of Italy when Italian hospitals became overwhelmed early into the pandemic. And Italian doctors started saying, okay, we're facing serious triage decisions. We've got thousands more patients than we can possibly treat. Resources are very limited. We're trying to figure out who can we treat and who do we have to let die, right? Who do we essentially sacrifice so we can save other people? And this became a discussion not only in the popular media, but also it ended up as a discussion in the medical ethics literature. So people started writing about this, trying to give advice to doctors and people in intensive care. How do you discuss these kinds of things? How do you decide on these kinds of things in like a hospital environment or a clinical environment? So there's a lot of concern over this because, again, the medical literature suggests that essentially triage decisions focus on utilitarian ethics of overall saving the most lives possible, of sacrificing those who cannot really be saved in order to achieve the greatest overall number. That's at least my understanding, and I'm happy to have a discussion with anyone who wants to talk about more nuance in that regard, since I'm a psychologist, not a medical doctor, right? But my understanding is that people are thinking about these things, people face these issues in medical wards during the dilemmas, during the pandemic. And so these are real life dilemmas that people are facing. And so the core of this work is that, what do people think about doctors who face these kinds of dilemmas? So imagine during the pandemic, there's Dr. Garner who says, well, the only thing you have to do, it's obviously logical that you have to sacrifice some to prioritize the overall group. That's just what you do during a pandemic. But over here, Dr. Blake says, no way, I can't do it. I care so much about my individual patients. I'm going to devote as much time and resources as I can to the patients I already have. And even if I've got a line of patients down the block, I haven't admitted those patients yet to my care. So these patients in my care, I'm going to spend all of my time and resources on them, regardless of how many I could potentially save by sacrificing some already in my care, right? So a situation roughly analogous to the classic trolley dilemma, the various other versions of the sacrificial. And what we predicted is that we would get a similar warmth competence trade-off for both classic dilemmas and for these new COVID-19 dilemmas that we wrote, right? So doctors who reject sacrifice should be viewed as warmer, but less competent. And those who accept this sacrifice should be viewed as competent, but less warm. We also then tested how would doctors who are practicing physicians in Florida hospitals compare to Florida students or online workers in Mechanical Turk. Perhaps you're familiar with Mechanical Turk or MTurk, if you will. A lot of people who work on these online platforms. And we compared how doctors versus students and MTurkers rated these, made these decisions and rated themselves after making these decisions. And then we also looked at warmth competence ratings of specific doctor who made a specific decision and also used different justifications, what we call either balanced or unbalanced justifications, right? And so I'll talk a little bit more about that later, but we thought that when doctors used more balanced justifications, that would help improve the perceptions of the weaker trait implied by their judgment. So if they accepted sacrifice, but they used a balanced justification, that would imply they're warmer than someone who doesn't. And if they reject sacrifice, but they used a balanced justification, that would imply they're more competent than someone who doesn't. Okay, before we did this though, we ran a couple pretests. So we ran a pretest number one on 250 MTurkers, where we provided them with three COVID dilemmas that we wrote and three classic sacrificial dilemmas. And we asked them overall, would you sacrifice harm to save lives? Is this not appropriate or is this appropriate? And also in pretest two, another 208 MTurkers. And we said, okay, imagine just a generic person made this other decision in a COVID or a classic dilemma. So what are your perceptions of their warmth and their competence? Yeah. All right. So what we did, by the way, the classic sacrificial dilemmas, we had three that are widely used or quite standard in the literature. We had the crying baby dilemma, where there's a potential to, you're hiding in a village with a baby who's about to cry, and these soldiers are coming to kill everyone hiding in this basement. And the question is, do you put your hand over the mouth of the baby to prevent them from crying, to prevent the soldiers from finding everyone, but doing so smothers the baby? And if you don't, then the soldiers find everyone, and everyone will be shot, right? We have also the motocross dilemma, where you're driving in a motocross race on a bike, and this biker is about to crash into five other people, causing a fiery crash. And you could kick them so that they go spinning off the track into a tree, which will be a fatal accident for them, but it'll prevent the five people from dying behind them. And we also have the firefighter dilemma. So you're a firefighter, you've got this huge ladder, there's an emergency situation, there's people in the third floor and on the second floor, and you could use your ladder to knock in the walls, right, to get and rescue the people on the second floor, but doing so will cause the person on the third floor to fall down. And so should you kill one person to essentially save roughly five other people? These are some classic sacrificial dilemmas that are pretty well understood in the general psychological literature. And what we did is we wrote some COVID-19 sacrificial dilemmas to hopefully have a lot of the same characteristics. So we wrote the pneumonia dilemma, where you could have this very ill pneumonia patient who's using a lot of time and resources, and it's the patient currently under your care, and you're a doctor, right? And you could abandon this patient and just let them pass away, and then use the time and resources that are freed from that to save five other COVID-19 patients who are waiting for care, who are potentially very high risk, because these are studies run at the very height of the pandemic and generally before the vaccine was available. We also had the COVID dilemma. So you've got a coma patient who is currently on a ventilator, and what you could do is remove the COVID, remove the ventilator from the coma patient and then use it to save a pregnant mother who has COVID and her unborn baby, right? So that you can save the life of both the mother and the baby, but the coma patient will then pass away. And we also had the treatment dilemma. So you as a doctor, and again, this is before the vaccine was developed, you could administer this new experimental treatment that will kill a small portion of the number of people who you administer to, but it will save the lives of many more people, right? So it's this risky treatment that you could administer with some risks, and you will be in a way directly responsible for some of the side effects that could be even fatal. But most people will then survive this wave of COVID that's coming at you as a result of your treatment. So those are the three dilemmas that we gave people. And here are the proportions of responses in study one. So three things to note here. First of all, we group them in the three on the left are classic sacrificial dilemmas. Three on the right are the COVID-19 sacrificial dilemmas. The axis here is the percentage of people who accepted or rejected sacrificial harm. So those accepted harm are in blue and who rejected in red. And so we found, similar to a lot of work, that there was, a fair amount of disagreement, but overall there was a trend towards a higher portion of people accepting sacrificial harm in the classic sacrificial dilemmas. And we also found a fair amount of disagreement, although a slightly higher proportion of people agreed that you should sacrifice one patient to save the others in the pneumonia, coma, and treatment dilemmas, right? Okay, so we have some disagreement here, but overall there is a trend where sacrificial harm, consistent with sort of utilitarian ethics as practiced by many hospitals, were generally fairly well accepted. Okay, so then we said, okay, what about perceptions? Imagine another person said, yes, this is okay, or no, this is not okay for each of these different dilemmas. And we used the classic measures of warmth and competence developed by Susan Fiske and colleagues. We just asked on 7-point scales, how good-natured is this person? How sincere? How warm? How tolerant? The Cronbach alpha was pretty good for those. Same for competence. We asked how competent, independent, confident, competitive, and intelligent was this person. We also measured perceptions of morality, but I'm not going to go into them too much today. Happy to talk about those later. But this is a pretty standard measure that's been used in hundreds of studies, warmth and competence perceptions. These are called the fundamental dimensions of person perception, because arguably they're the two most important aspects, along with morality, that people really care about when they meet another person and decide to interact with them. Okay, so what did we find? So we again have classic dilemmas on the left and COVID dilemmas on the right. And what we did is we, first of all, replicated previous research, finding that for classic dilemmas, people who said, no, I won't cause harm, I'm not going to sacrifice this individual, even though I could save other lives, they were viewed as higher in warmth, but lower in competence. And conversely, those who said, yeah, I'm going to sacrifice this individual because I need to save the overall group, they were rated lower in warmth, but higher in competence. We got the classic interaction, the classic trade-off that we got in previous work. And we found that same pattern for both classic and for COVID-19 dilemmas. In fact, the two-way interaction here is significant, but the three-way interaction is not significant, suggesting we got the same pattern overall across both classic and COVID dilemmas. So again, for COVID dilemmas, those who say, no, I won't sacrifice, I'm gonna give all of my care and attention to this one patient I already have, no matter what. They said, wow, that's a really warm person, they're really great, but on the other hand, they're kind of not the best leader, or this is not the best, most logical decision. And on the other hand, when someone said, I'm going to sacrifice this patient to save as many as I possibly can, people said, wow, that's a really great leader. It's a very intelligent decision, but that's kind of cold and immoral, isn't it? And incidentally, I won't talk much about the morality findings, but in general, perceptions of morality look like perceptions of warmth, right? Warmth and morality are highly correlated around 0.7, whereas perceptions of competence and warmth are correlated around 0.4. And in general, perceptions of morality are looking similar to warmth, but they're actually generally higher, right? Or they're more extreme, right? So those rejecting sacrificial harm are looked as particularly moral as well as somewhat warm, but less competent, right? On both classic and COVID sacrificial dilemmas. Okay, so those are some pretests. And then we said, okay, let's do study one, where we'll look at, we'll take these COVID dilemmas we've developed, and we're going to provide them now to three different samples. So we got 387 currently practicing healthcare workers in Florida. The majority of them were doctors or physicians. The majority, again, working in like hospital settings, although a fair chunk were also working in like clinics and things like that. We got over 1,000 online workers, MTurkers, and we got almost 700 university students who were at a large university in Florida. Okay, and so we gave them, each of them, these three COVID-19 sacrificial dilemmas, the coma dilemma, pneumonia dilemma, the treatment dilemma, and we asked them what their decision was. Is this appropriate or not to sacrifice these lives? We also asked for open-ended reasoning that they could provide. So we sort of gave them a box after each dilemma. Why did you choose that? And we actually drew upon these reasons for study two. And we also asked them to rate themselves in terms of warmth and competence after each of their decisions. But how did they perceive themselves after making these choices? Yeah. So what we found, first of all, is what are the choices that people made? So here is the, on the left, the pneumonia dilemma. And just as before, we have the percentage of people accepting or rejecting harm on the axis. So those in blue said, yes, I would sacrifice one to save five. And those in red said, no, I wouldn't, right? And so, and in each case, we have the students and the healthcare providers and then the online workers, right? So as you can see, the students and healthcare providers were quite similar. They were both somewhere in the middle. They were quite strongly divided for the pneumonia dilemma. And the online workers were rather more accepting of sacrificial harm, which was actually surprising to us. We thought that actually doctors might be more willing to accept sacrifices than other people, but they in fact weren't. And if anything, they were slightly less willing than students on the coma dilemma to accept sacrificial harm. So doctors were rather reluctant to agree to sacrificial harms, at least in some of these cases, even though overall, I mean, there was never a majority of doctors who rejected sacrificial harm. And in some cases, especially for the treatment dilemma, a majority of people, doctors and non-doctors, agreed, yeah, this is a worthwhile thing to do. And again, this is months before the vaccine was developed. So all this concern about the vaccine and side effects and so on, well, it seems widely supported that even if there were serious side effects of the vaccine, it's still a worthwhile thing to do in the eyes of great many people, and especially among online workers. Right, so online workers were showing a really, really high response rate there, higher than either doctors or students. So that surprised me. Might be the highest group. Okay, then what else have we got? Study one. We then asked people about self-perception. So rate yourself on warmth and competence after your decision. And again, we have students, healthcare workers, and MTurkers. And so one thing to note is that we again found the two-way interaction in each of the three cases, right? But the effects were a lot weaker than in other work, a lot weaker than when people rate other people. This pattern actually is consistent with a 2018 paper that we published, where we asked people to rate other people and then also rate themselves. And what we found is that when people rate other people, you get a very strong warmth-competence trade-off, this sort of classic trade-off structure. But when people rate themselves, they tend to generally rate themselves fairly high in warmth and competence, regardless of their decision. And one of the reasons that may be is that when you rate other people, you largely have their decision to go off of. So you know, if they said, no way, I would never cause harm, you think, wow, they must have had such strong emotions, but you don't really know a lot more than that. And if you say, well, they will accept harm, they must have thought really carefully about this, but you don't have much more information. But when you are rating yourself, you know how torn you feel between these different impulses. You know, oh, I really don't want to cause harm, but on the other hand, those are a lot of lives I could save. And you can personally feel torn between these different options. So you have this extra source of information, not just what judgment do you reach, but also what are some of the internal processes that you're experiencing as you reach that decision. So people tend to rate themselves quite high in warmth and competence when they rate themselves. That said, overall, there was a main effect so that people rated themselves higher, especially in warmth. There was an interaction. So people rate themselves especially high in warmth when they reject harm, right? So there is some degree of consistency between self-perception and other perception or meta-perception, right? This idea that people know, like, if I'm going to reject harm, I'm a particularly warm person. There was also an effect where healthcare providers tended to rate themselves higher than other people. And in one of the reasons for that is that students rated themselves extremely low in competence when they rejected harm. Right. So it's surprising to us that this pattern with students, they were quite different than healthcare providers or MTurkers. Right. They were very, very concerned about how dumb they felt when they said, no, I wouldn't cause harm, even save lives. And yet they nonetheless went through and did that. Okay, so study one, self-perceptions. With this in mind, we then said, okay, let's now look at perceptions of a specific medical practitioner, right? It can be different to sort of just say, here's a generic person making a choice versus this person is a doctor, they are in a hospital, they are personally experiencing the dilemma, and they come up with not only an answer, but also we talked about their justification for their decision. So again, we gave them these versions of these dilemmas. We said, okay, here's a doctor, and they said, yes, prioritize the group, sacrifice one to save these others, or no, don't sacrifice one, even though others will die. And what we did, so we actually used this photo of this doctor. We called him Dr. Stevens. We told them, we got a large sample of online workers. So Dr. Stevens works in this emergency ward. He's affected by, deeply affected by COVID-19. So they're sort of inundated with patients. And Dr. Stevens was faced with this difficult decision. He had to accept or reject sacrifice. And he explained his decision as follows, right? And then we randomized whether they got the coma dilemma, treatment dilemma, or the pneumonia dilemma. And we came up with justifications for each of these dilemmas. And in each case, we used either what we called unbalanced or balanced justifications, right? So in the case of an unbalanced justification for rejecting sacrifice, the idea was the justification itself refers to emotional concern consistent with perceptions of that judgment as warm and a discussion of the sacrificial target only, right? There's not a discussion of the overall group. So for example, this doctor wrote, no, I don't feel I could stop ongoing care on one patient to give it to another. Removal of ongoing treatment feels like I'm harming them and it's never okay to abandon a patient. They talk about guilt. They talk about how it's unethical. They talk about how life is sacred. And these are real responses taken from real doctors during study one, right? So we looked at doctors and we said, okay, those making this decision and this decision, we borrowed quotes directly from what they wrote and we plugged them in here. Okay. An unbalanced decision regarding accepting sacrifice, instead of being this sort of warm emotional focus on the individual sacrificial target, we now try to talk about logical concern for the group only. So this doctor instead, and again, these are real quotes taken from the practicing physicians. They said, I would stop ongoing care for this patient. Medicine is not first come, first serve. It's a mass casualty situation. So appropriate triage is key. Saving five versus one is a no-brainer because statistics favor that decision. Patients die and doctors need to accept that. Everyone's equal. The needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few, and so on. So they were talking about this group. The group is paramount. You've got to save the group. And they weren't using a lot of emotion language to talk about how they felt about the fact that they have to sacrifice a human being to achieve that group, right? Whereas the person before, the unbalanced reject sacrifice, doesn't really mention the group at all. They're just really focused on this patient. They have this guilt. It's unethical. They don't want to abandon this patient. Their whole focus is on the individual. We also, though, gave people balanced decisions, what we call balanced or justifications, right? So when they rejected sacrifice, we tried to combine this emotional concern for the sacrificial target together with logical concern for the overall group, right? So this doctor said, okay, I would reject the sacrifice. I'm not going to kill this person, but I understand the decisions like this must be made, right? And then they had some reasons for why they had their judgment. I should follow through. It's my responsibility. Doctors cannot make this trade for what is known, for what isn't known. And they raise this hypothetical of what if I abandon this person and everyone dies too, you know, I'm not like a worse person. So they're focused on both the individual to be sacrificed and the group to be saved. They're trying to raise both logical and emotional considerations. And finally, we had a balanced decision of someone who's going to accept sacrifice, again, trying to combine emotional concern for the sacrificial target together with logical concern, the overall outcome. So this doctor said, yes, I would stop ongoing care for one patient to save the others because every life is invaluable, even though every life is invaluable. In times of crisis, I have to devote resources and redirect my focus and attention to those who I can save the most, but it's tough It's emotionally exhausting. I would lose sleep. But then again, there's this principle of beneficence. I have to help the most people. The greatest good is what I need to do, etc. So they're combining this. They're indicating that they're both a warm, emotional, trustworthy individual who cares about specific patients, but they're trying to keep the greater good in mind. Yeah, everybody with me so far? Okay, so here is what we found. Okay, right. So we had perceptions of Dr. Stevens. We had how warm and competent are they? How much concern do they have for the individual target and the group? And we also asked, okay, do you want them to run the hospital and do you want them to be your own doctor? And we also, by the way, measured reactance to medical advice. So we're going to come back to this, right? So some people say, no way, I'm not going to do what my doctor says. Forget doctors, forget the medical system. I've got my own decisions to make. Sounds familiar, I imagine, right? Okay, so here's what we found for warmth and for competence. So we overall found somewhat of a similar pattern as before. We generally had this interaction effect, but it wasn't quite as clean as it was in the previous studies. And the main reason for this is that in general, for both balanced and unbalanced justifications, people rated the doctor who rejected sacrificial harm as higher in competence than previously. In fact, doctors who rejected sacrificial harm did not seem to face a warmth competence trade-off the way they did before, whereas doctors who accepted sacrificial harm did. Right? They said, well, if you accept harm, you are a competent, logical, intelligent leader, but cold and untrustworthy and immoral. But doctors who said, no, I'm going to reject sacrifice, people said, well, it's pretty warm and moral and trustworthy, but also pretty logical and competent. So this surprised us. It may be that our justifications, by having the justification, by having the doctor explain their decision, they didn't just seem to be irrational or purely emotional in their judgment, but it seems that they arrived at that judgment through a reasoned process. Remember, this was different than the pretest where we did show a clear trade-off for doctors who rejected or individuals who rejected sacrificial harm. Now, that said, we did find a small boost for those making balanced justifications, right? So there was a small boost specifically to the process that seemed like the weaker process. It was a small effect, but it was significant, right? So overall, by providing a balanced justification, it was possible to look a little bit warmer when you accept sacrifice and a little bit more competent when you reject sacrificial harm. Okay, we also got a clearer effect on perceived concern for the individual and for the group, right? So we asked people, okay, in this dilemma, how much was this doctor focused on this one individual that they could sacrifice and how much were they focused on the overall group? And for both unbalanced and balanced justifications, we got a full interaction, the trade-off effect. So doctors who says, no, I'm not going to cause harm, even to save lives, they said, wow, they're really focused on the individual. And doctors said, I care about the group. That's what my focus is. I'm not going to sacrifice. I will sacrifice to save the group. People said, yeah, they're definitely focused on the group. But by providing balanced justifications, it was possible to increase perceptions of concern for the alternate target. So if you are going to sacrifice someone, but you talk about your concern for them, you seem more balanced, concern for both, as opposed to just talking about the one target that you're trying to save or the one group you're trying to save. Yeah. Perceived concern for the individual and the group. We also asked people, hey, who do you want to run the hospital and who do you want for your own doctor? And here we again got an interaction effect, but if you recall from previous work, it was a full crossover interaction. We didn't quite get that again. Instead, we got a main effect so that overall people preferred doctors who said, no way, I'm not going to sacrifice an individual even to save lives. And they preferred them for both their own doctor and to run a hospital. Although the effect was stronger for people saying, I want this person for my own doctor. So that was consistent with the idea that people are really seeking someone who is warm and trustworthy for their own practitioner. But given these effects do make sense in the sense that they rated doctors who rejected harm higher in competence in these studies than they have in past work. Okay, so a couple more things and then we'll take a few questions. I measured a bunch of other stuff I didn't really have time to talk about. So we measured performance on the CRT, the cognitive reflection task, which predicts sort of your ability to reason carefully about mathematical problems. We measured emotional closeness to victims, how connected you feel to this sacrificial target, your mentality, how much of this pandemic like a war, how bad is the pandemic in your area right now, overall at things like work experience and other demographics like age, gender, religiosity, political orientation. And we use that together with doctors' decisions to predict how reactant are you to medical advice about the pandemic. And again, this is still fairly early in the pandemic. This is before vaccines were available, but things like social distancing and masks were highly popular at this point in time, right? Or at least that they were widespread, I should say. And what I've done is highlight things for you in red, things that were predictors of reactance. People saying, I'm angry. I don't want to follow medical advice. And in blue, things that predicted saying, yeah, I listen to doctors. I do whatever doctors say. So as you can see, the people who said they were more reactant to or less willing to follow medical advice when they were older, when they were male, when they were more religious, and when they were more conservative as opposed to liberal. And interestingly, when they had stronger emotional closeness to victims. This one actually worked in the opposite direction as our original prediction. A lot of research shows that sort of this empathic concern or emotional concern for individuals tends to predict, I don't want to sacrifice them. How well do these things predict your willingness to sacrifice? And this one, yeah, it worked a little bit opposite the way that we thought it would. But essentially, people who are more emotionally close to victims were willing to sacrifice people, but also reacting to pandemic medical advice. They were concerned, I guess, overall about how they would be treated in the medical system. On the other hand, people who showed greater logical cognitive reasoning skills on the CRT, who viewed the pandemic as like a war, and who were also higher in work experience, they all said, yeah, I listen to doctors, I do what doctors say. I'm ready to listen to medical advice, just whatever doctors tell me, it's totally fine, right? We didn't find evidence that the specific doctor's decision or justification itself was a significant predictor above and beyond these other factors. We didn't find a lot of interaction effects. I'll just show you one in step three here. But overall, this actually does make sense that if in general, in the psych literature, if you measure general attitudes to medical advice, you should measure general perceptions. If you're measuring specific individuals and then general perceptions, it doesn't predict very well. So we aren't too surprised by this result. And but this overall pattern does seem to make sense. Okay, just a few conclusions here, and then we'll talk about some questions. So overall, these reactants to medical advice, I won't do what doctors say, we're not really affected by the decision or the justification. But people who are older, male, religious, conservative, and more emotionally connected to victims were more reactant versus people who were higher in cognitive reflection, wartime perceptions, and work experience, less reactive. And some more general conclusions. So overall, across these studies, people seem to perceive COVID-19 and classic dilemmas similarly. And this is kind of a puzzle because medical ethics prioritize this utilitarian triage to save the most lives possible. And there's this sort of warmth, confidence trade-off, at least for many people, right? The sacrifice to save lives seems like it's logical and competent, but it also comes across as cold and heartless, right? So this is a real danger for a lot of doctors. There's a disagreement over the sacrificial action with about 2/3 of people in many cases favoring sacrificial harm, this utilitarian solution, but at least, you know, a pretty robust minority also saying, no, instead the right thing to do is to reject sacrificial harm, the deontological solution. And healthcare providers generally were similar or less willing to sacrifice than students, and much less willing to sacrifice than online workers. So healthcare providers seem particularly concerned about this sort of sacrifice. And when healthcare workers rejected harm, they rated themselves particularly high in warmth, but overall rated themselves quite high in both warmth and competence, whereas students felt very, very incompetent after rejecting sacrificial harm. One more set of conclusions here, right? So people perceived healthcare workers who accepted sacrificial harm as competent, but especially cold, and focused on the group, but not the individual. And they were not really preferred to run either the hospital or as one's own doctor, which is again, a problem because this is the ethics that is predominant in most medical settings, right? On the other hand, people perceive healthcare workers who say, no way, I'm gonna focus all of my time and energy on this patient I already have, regardless of how many I have waiting up outside the door. They were viewed as warm and competent as focused on the individual, albeit less on the group, although with some justifications, they could improve that perception. And these people were preferred to run the hospital and especially as one's own doctor. And again, balanced justifications, increased concerns for the targets not saved, and generally perceptions of the alternate response pattern. So overall, If you are one of these two doctors, yes, prioritize the group, no, prioritize the individual. People less prefer this idea of prioritizing the group and more prefer the idea of prioritizing the individual. But when you add in the possibility to justify, you can say, yes, prioritize the group, but I also care about the individual. That seems more effective. And you can say, prioritize the individual, but I also care about the group. That both of those seem more effective. Okay, thanks. Any questions?